Well, for those of you who did notice, although some of you probably didn't, I have been absent for the last 2 weeks. For the last 2 weeks, I've spent that time in the Philippines with a team of six. Four of us, myself included, were from Impact here, and then we had two from Grace Canberra, Brian Medway's church. So we had myself, obviously, and then we had Jody and Sarah and Laban. So this is definitely the smallest team, I think, that I've ever taken to the Philippines, but it was a good team and it was a fruitful time. And I have to take a moment just to commend Jody and Sarah and Laban. You guys already know this, but we have some exceptional young people here in the church. Jody's going to take up an offering. No, just kidding. No, you could not have asked a better representative for our church, as well as a better representative for the kingdom of God than those three. And I don't say that lightly, because we've taken a lot of people over the years, but they were exceptional. So you have some great young people. Get around them, encourage them while you can. While I was on Commodities, we got to do a lot of different things. You'll hear from the team in the coming weeks about some of them about the ongoing work that's going on there. But I had the opportunity, much to the dismay of certain team members who should remain nameless, to actually preach five times whilst on Commodities on a variety of topics, and you know who you are as well. But this is what it looks like when you're preaching in the Philippines, right? You're preaching with an interpreter to a very mixed group of people. So you're preaching to some who are highly educated, all the way to those who would be illiterate, right? And some are very well acquainted with the Word of God, all the way to people who have never actually read the Word of God for themselves. And for those of you who are maybe unfamiliar, I know many of you here have been to the Philippines. The Philippines is around 80% Roman Catholic, about 10% Protestant, only which 2% are kind of, you know, evangelical, mainstream, we would say, Christian. The remaining 8% in that Protestant group are considered, or would be considered, a cult. You've got 6% who are Muslim and 4% in the other category. So wherever I go, I generally have this idea or understanding that I am going to be conversing with people who have some sort of idea, concept about God, about His Son, about the church. But I guess I use that word understanding loosely. There are two things that stand out to me each time, and this was my first time back in 5 years, just because of COVID. Prior to that, I think almost every year since 2007 I have been in the Philippines. So some things have changed, some things have not. This has become more noticeable, and as I tell you these things, I'm going to use the Philippines as an example, but do not think that, you know, we are vastly different in the West, because you will recognize this yourself. So two things that really stood out to me were these things. Firstly, and I want to borrow this quote from John Piper, he said this: "The most wicked export of the Western church to the third world is the prosperity gospel." Yes. Right? And to say that the prosperity gospel is rife in the evangelical church in the Philippines, that would be the understatement of the year. And you'll be hard-pressed to find many congregations, there are some, but you'll be hard-pressed to find many where, you know, this is not the source of every issuing stream. And like, you know, a virulent disease, the prosperity gospel affects everything that it gets hold of, everything that it touches. And so you have these people, especially on Camotes Island, they're living in abject poverty, being told to declare, "You are rich, just say it, I am rich, I am rich." Being told that if they give a seed, that's such a Christian thing, right? If they give a seed, and by seed, we all know what that means, you know, you give financially, give a seed to the church, you will attain financial blessing, more than you can imagine, you're going to be rich. And so when you realize the extent of the disconnect between their theology and the reality in which they live, you grasp the enormity of the deception that many of these people are under. and it will break your heart. Rather than the Christ-centered gospel, you have this man-centered gospel, because the focus is on self and what they can attain. And so the focus shifts from the preeminence of Christ to the endless pursuit of financial breakthrough. You hear that all the time. And I want to say this morning, if you personally are entrenched in this, I guarantee this is all that you're going to take away from what I've just said. Yeah, Sam, you just believe in a poverty gospel. I've been accused of that before. Sam doesn't believe Christians should have money. Sam's just saying that because he doesn't have enough faith himself for financial breakthrough. And to that, I would say, maybe say those same things to the Filipino Christians on Komotis in their shacks. Maybe they just need more faith to achieve wealth. Maybe they just didn't declare that the cherry-picked scriptures well enough or in the right way, right? Unless maybe, you know, I missed the part in the Bible that talks about, you know, there being a different dispensation of wealth for Christians in different portions and parts of the world, right? Sam doesn't believe those things. Sam is just trying to believe God's word. I do not believe the prosperity gospel is what we find in scripture. And so where does this lead people, right? When you've been promised wealth and health and prosperity for every single season, right? And you're doing everything that you've been told to do to attain it, but nothing is changing. And that leads me to my second observation. Faith-based religion has morphed into works-based religion. Right? And don't get me wrong, you speak to most evangelical churches here and in the Philippines, right? They will espouse Romans 5:1, that justification is by faith. But their behavior so often contradicts this. And this is the natural outworking church of the prosperity gospel. How we relate to a loving father just becomes transactional rather than relational. And what happens when there's seemingly a problem with the transaction? Well, it's easy. We just modify our behavior and our actions in this formulaic way until we can achieve our desired result. I don't know if you ever had a password that you couldn't remember. And these days, you know, we've got a lot of these smartphones, a lot of your computers, they'll have like your iPhones, like your keychain. So you type it in and it remembers it for you. But I'm sure you've all experienced setting a password and then sitting there just trying to type example after example and going, oh, what could it be? What did I set this as? And it's very frustrating, right? You're putting all the different ones that you can remember in the hopes that you're going to get it right. And this is what it can look like with transactional Christians, right? The effort's going to try to get what they want from password-protected vending machine Jesus. And what does that actually look like practically? Not synonymous. It looks practically like works, all right? Maybe if I give more to the church, maybe that will put me in God's good graces, and then he'll be more likely to get those, you know, the cattle on 1,000 hills, and he'll put them in my pen. Maybe if I attend church more, maybe if I donate more, right? Maybe if I serve more, maybe if I attend more midweek activities, that will tip the scales for me. That will force God's hand. He will have no choice but to bless me, to prosper me, to give me the money and the things that I am so desperate for. And do you know what the most awful thing about this is? That I can say, at least on paper, at least 80% of the Filipino population lives in this way. In their Roman Catholicism, and that has creeped into the church. You see, when your religion is faith plus works, how do you ever know if you've done enough? Right? How do you know how much to do to achieve the desired effect that you are seeking, both in this life and for salvation in the next? Well, you don't, right? No one ever does, especially regarding salvation. And I think one of the most awful things for someone who would say they are a disciple of Jesus would be for them to live in a place where they believe that they have no assurance of their salvation. And so this type of religion, faith plus works, where they're constantly trying to earn something from God, earn his favor, earn his blessing, earn his prosperity, earn his salvation, right? The fruit of this type of religion is the following, and we could have made a big list, but firstly, And this is what I observe, again, a joyless faith. Church is attended as a duty and not out of love for God and His church. Money, any money that's given, unlikely to be given cheerfully, right? Or in service to God's kingdom. Nor are we going to serve with a good heart as well. Rather, all of this becomes a box-ticking exercise as opposed to acts that flow, firstly, out of love. Another fruit is a shallow faith. Because rather than a devotion to the full counsel of Scripture that we're called to, any attention given in church or any attention given to the Word is primarily focused on Scriptures that are speaking directly to wants. What do I want? I want blessing, I want health, I want prosperity. Right, so all of the focus is on a few select Scriptures. How can I use God's Word and somehow get it and apply it to get what I want in this life? To be rich, to be prosperous, to be healthy all the time. And you know me, I'm not saying that it is wrong to be healthy. Amen to health. Amen to wealth. Amen to prosperity. But the problem is, when this is the focus of your gospel, it is a man-made gospel, right? And the problem is, when you live like that, spiritual infancy, immaturity becomes a permanent state, right? And to make matters worse, Christians miss out on the most incredible, abundant, and joy-filled life, the most fulfilled life that comes only through surrender to and communion with Christ. This isn't experienced, church, through the attainment of wealth. If you think that's going to bring you satisfaction and close communion with Christ, that is not right. And so, in the Philippines, this is what you see. You have millions attending Mass, millions attending church services every week in the Philippines, sitting there, miserable on the inside, and many visibly miserable on the outside too, and uninterested. And why? Well, I think you and I would be too if we were dragging ourselves along each week, having no real assurance of our salvation, stuck in this never-ending hamster wheel of works, trying to do enough to attain our wants and ensure our salvation. And what an awful way to live. What an awful thing to hold us in bondage. But this is the beauty, church, of the true gospel. Not only is our justification and our regeneration not dependent on our works, but we can have assurance of our salvation. And so today's message I've titled, How Do I Know I'm Saved? Don't know if you've ever asked yourself that question at any point in your life, during your Christian walk. Maybe you're new to the faith and you've asked that fairly recently, or maybe you're a believer who's been on this journey for a long time, and you still asked it. I was thinking about this, and this reminds me a little bit of married couples. And think about this particular picture, right? How many of you have been married for many years, and maybe one night you're trying to go to bed, and your wife rolls over, she turns to you, and you're just about to fall asleep, and she says something like, "Do you still love me?" You say, "Yes, of course I do." Go back to sleep. Roll back over. Why did you bother me with that? I'm trying to fall asleep. I've got to work. That doesn't happen in my house. I've heard it happens with some people, right? Do you still love me? Now, I'm sure that your wife knows that you love her. I'm sure that she's experienced your love in numerous ways, right? And yet, the question still gets asked, even if you think it may seem silly. And yes, of course, I know husbands ask this question. They can do this to their wives too. But this can be like us. We've been saved by Christ. We've been justified. We've been redeemed. We've been regenerated. But this does not always make us immune from asking this question sometimes. We are human. And, church, this question needs an answer. It cannot go ignored. Because you wouldn't ignore your husband or your wife if they asked that question. Do you still love me? Go to bed. Yeah, you wouldn't do that. That could be detrimental. So what are the dangers if you leave that question unanswered? Well, we've already mentioned the first one. We start to live a works-based life. You know, because we are unsure if we are recipients of God's salvation, we end up somehow attempting to earn our salvation, to earn His approval and affection. And maybe this is subconscious, but we might do it by, you know, attending church regularly, or giving more money, or just doing more charitable acts. And we live in this constant state of unease. Yeah? Am I right with a holy and just God? You know, I messed up this week. I sinned. I fell. Maybe now I have tipped the scales over to the hell side, right? Unless maybe I can somehow do something to please him, maybe I'm not going to make it into heaven. Well, what if I drop dead now? I could be in big trouble. Maybe I won't enjoy a relationship with him in this life. And this is a horrible way to live, church. Because, subsequently, and our second reason, the foundation of our obedience moves from love to fear. In John 14:15, Jesus said this: if you love me, you'll obey my commandments. Not, if you're afraid of hell, you'll obey my commandments. Or, you know, if you want my blessing, you'll obey my commandments. No, he said, if you love me, it will manifest as obedience to my life-giving word. All obedience should ultimately flow from love, church. All of it. Right? Nothing else is sustainable for long-term obedience and righteous living. Anything else as the primary motivator renders the Christian life completely joyless. And we saw this behavior. We see this all the time. You know, people just trying to be good people, trying to do this in their own strength, right? Oh, I'm just going to obey God because if I don't, he's going to send me to hell. And they grit their teeth and they're trying to do the right thing. But they fall short. And so they live in this horrible state where they're constantly trying to live for, you know, what they believe to be God's approval. So you might be thinking at this point, well, should we even be entertaining this question, Sam? Right? Is this a healthy question for us to ask? Oh, are we saved? Should we be asking that? I believe it's a question that we all will ask at some point. And the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 13:5, he says this: examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Examine yourselves, from the Greek word perezo, meaning to make proof of, to test. Right? So if we are told to look for proof or to test if we're in the faith, if we've been saved into the one true gospel, then it stands to reason that there has to be an answer, there has to be an evidence, there has to be a sign or a proof that would indicate that we are in fact saved. Because the Apostle Paul wouldn't say it otherwise. Otherwise, what's the point of examining if you don't know what you're looking for? Examine yourself to see whether you are in the faith. So, we should not shy away from answering this question. We need to know, we need to examine ourselves, we need assurance. How can you point people towards Christ if you're not even sure yourself? Right? We need, as disciples of Jesus, assurance. Allow me to read from one of my favorite passages of Scripture. If you have your Bibles, please turn there with me, or your iPhones. Ephesians 2, 1 to 9. We're going to pause in Ephesians 2, 1 to 9 for a moment. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. And here's the thing, church, we were all dead. We were once dead in our trespasses and our sins. We were necros. Necros. I didn't say anything else. Necros, right? In terms of our spirit. That word dead that we read, necros, it means like a corpse. Okay? That is how we walked, following Satan, amongst those who also walked in this way, living in the passions of our flesh and carrying out the selfish and sinful desires of the body and the mind. And I was going to ask, how many of you can relate to this today? Each and every disciple of Jesus can relate to this. We know this was our state. Scripture tells us, we know within ourselves, before we came to Christ, this was our state. Does everyone know what I mean when I talk about a life ring? A life ring, like a life buoy. You know, on boats, you have the rope and then the ring and you throw it. Right, so, little story, but as some of you will know, Caleb, my younger brother, got married in July of this year. A few weeks before his wedding, we had a buck celebration. So at the Gold Coast, we hired a little pontoon boat that you can drive out in the water, and you find little sandbar, you can have a barbecue. So it was really nice. But Andrew Schenk was the captain, and we kind of anchored the boat, and all of the young guys, we said, oh, why don't you go and swim to the beach, the sandbar there, kick the footy around. Andrew and I are going to do some cooking, and we'll call you back when it's ready. And so we watched them all swim out, and one of the guys is not particularly fit. He's not a great swimmer, so we kind of, watch him flounder his way to shore, have a bit of a chuckle to ourselves, wickedly. Anyway, the food's done, we're ready. In the meantime, a current has picked up in this little channel. So it's, probably about 50 metres they've got to swim to the boat. So we're like, food's ready. And the guys start swimming. And they start swimming on one end of the sandbar. By the time they're getting to the boat, they're down the other end. The current is strong. And as they're climbing into the boat, I make a comment. I'm like, someone should go and check on such and such. I'm not saying that person's name, because some of you will know this guy. Andrew and I we joked, someone better check on him. And we look and we see him, and he's been swept to the other end of the boat. He's not made it to the boat. And as we're looking at him, his head is going under, and he's vomited, and then he's sucked it back in. He's drowning. And so we start screaming, because we're on the other end of the boat. Someone help him! Saying his name. Someone help him! Someone jump and grab him! And in classic, undeveloped prefrontal cortex fashion, all of the guys were watching their friend bop up and down and drown. And I was like, throw the life ring! Throw the life ring! And someone goes, the life ring's missing! I'm like, what do you mean it's missing? It was there like 5 minutes ago. Anyway, we end up getting rescued, and within like a minute of getting him onto the boat, he's there, he's repenting, he's turning back to God, he's seen a life flash before his eyes, and then the guys are just making fun of him, and so that still continues on. But all that to say, it would have been really useful to throw the life ring. And a week later, a photo emerged. I got to see it, and it was a photo of Caleb standing on the roof of the boat wearing the life ring, and he'd left it up there. No use, right? Being on the roof of the boat when your friend is drowning. Church, do you know you cannot throw a life ring to a corpse and expect them to grab on? Why? Because they cannot do anything to help themselves. And this was our state before Christ saved us, right? Not a man treading water, merely being limited by his sin. I don't know if I mentioned this in the service, but I know they talked about it in another gospel, about us receiving a gospel pamphlet from a church in the area, and it said there, sin has limited us. Sin has not limited you. In fact, sin had left you dead, rotting like a corpse. That is the reality of sin. Never buy into the lie that sin just limits you in your life. It leads to death, right? There was not a more hopeless position that we could have found ourselves in. But God, knowing this, right? Knowing everything about us, knowing every sin that we've committed, every sin that we would ever still commit, right? Being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were so dead in our trespasses and our sins, he made us alive together with Christ. And I love this. You know why? Because this punches any sort of works-based gospel straight in the mouth. Romans 5:8, but God shows his love for us in that whilst we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I love this. Whilst we were still sinners, whilst we were still spiritual corpses, spiritually dead, right? Whilst we had no power or ability to try and better ourselves, to clean ourselves up, to make ourselves look better, more appealing to him, before we could do anything to try and save ourselves, right? Whilst we were still in our sin and dead, Christ died for us. He made you and I alive together. And surely this is the goodness of God that leads men and women to repentance. This is good news this morning, church.
Amen. Good
Verse 5b, halfway through verse 5 to 7, it says, by grace you have been saved and raised up with him and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. I love this. By grace we have been saved. By God's undeserved, unmerited favor, we have been saved and seated with Christ in heavenly places. And this is an incredible spiritual reality for us, church. Our position now and for eternity. Romans 8:17 tells us that we are co-heirs with Christ. That's amazing. Paul goes on and he says this again, right? Further on in Ephesians 2. He's just said it once. By grace we've been saved. He says it again. By grace we've been saved through faith. And we talk all the time about justification by faith alone. And for those of you who were here last week, I know that John talked to you about justification. But I'll remind you again. You have been justified, church. And that word is a legal term. Justification is an act of God whereby he pronounces a sinner to be righteous because of that sinner's faith in Christ. You have been made legally right before him. Church, you stand right before God because by grace you have been saved through faith. Right? He is rich in mercy and he is great in his love for you and I. Not of our own doing. It is the gift of God. And not a result of works or anything you and I could do, so that none of us could ever boast. You heard Paul Washer say this, but he was not the original. It was Jonathan Edwards, and maybe he even stole it from someone. But Jonathan Edwards said, you contribute nothing to your salvation except for the sin that made it necessary. Right? And this is the greatest news I've ever heard, because I was dead, church. You and I were dead. And I could not have grabbed that life ring, even if I tried. But God so loved you, and he so loved me, that he sent his son to die for us and pay the debt for my sin and your sin, which was death. Right? And when we grasp our position outside of Christ and the reality of the good news of Jesus, it transforms our lives. We are filled with joy. We are filled with peace. We no longer have to strive to earn his love and affection, or his favor, or strive to earn our salvation, right? Our obedience is offered to God out of love and not fear. We are truly set free from the bondage and slavery of sin. No more do we need to wonder if we've done enough to earn our salvation. No more do we need to strive out of fear or obey only out of duty or serve purely for like a perceived benefit that maybe I can get. Right? No more do we have to live in the bondage that works-merited salvation seeks to oppress us with. This is what separates Christianity, church, true Christianity, from every single other religion. You do not do anything to merit your salvation. It is a gift of God.
Amen.
By grace, through faith.
That's it.
I want to give you three proofs this morning. Right? Three proofs from 1 John that you could look for in your life to answer that question, how do I know that I am saved? And I want to clarify, these three things do not earn your salvation. And if you think that, you probably missed the first half of this message, right? Nor are there only three proofs. But when you are saved by grace through faith, these three things are evidenced in some way in your life. Right? Examine yourselves to see you're in the faith. These are things that you can examine your life for. So the first proof that we have is theological. You have assurance of your salvation if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. 1 John 5:10-13. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. And I love this. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. That word has the martyria, the evidence. Right? Whoever believes in the Son of God has the evidence in himself, in herself. And I would ask us these things this morning. Church, do you believe that you were dead in your sins? Do you believe that we have all fallen short of the glory of God? And do you believe that the wages for our sin was death? Do we believe that God sent his one and only Son to this earth, fully man and fully God, to live a perfect and a sinless life, to suffer and be crucified and die for our sins? Do you believe he was buried in Joseph's tomb? And that on the third day he rose from the dead, conquering death and hell? Do you believe that the curtain has been torn in two, and that we are no longer separated from a holy, loving, and a perfect Father, but instead we can enjoy perfect communion with him? We can enjoy his abundant life and eternity in heaven, not by anything that you and I have done, but because he so loved us, in accordance with his words in John 3, chapter 16. Do we believe that this morning? Is that the foundation of our lives, church? Is this our starting point, our springboard, our frame of reference, the lens in or by which we view everything else? Right, if we believe in the Son of God, not just a mental assent like, oh yeah, yeah, he's God's Son, right? But believing as to put our trust in him, in his saving work, then we have proof of our salvation, because salvation lives within us. That is what 1 John tells us. Romans 10:9-10 tells us, this backs it up, scripture backs up scripture. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. And church, if you believe in the Son of God and rightfully recognize and say, he is my Lord and he is my Savior, and God, I am putting my trust in you for my salvation, scripture says that you have been saved. That is a proof that you have been saved. The second proof, church, is a moral proof. You should have assurance of your salvation if you live a righteous life. 1 John 3:6-9. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him. And he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. And so what are we talking about here? What was John talking about in this passage? Is he saying that when you and I sin, we do not abide in Christ? And I remember being part of a church many years ago where most Sundays they would have an altar call. And do you know, we don't have look at this place, you know. We don't have an altar, even if we tried. Couldn't have an altar here. We don't believe in altars, and that's why you probably see that we do not regularly do altar calls, although we do believe that the gospel should be preached, and God will do what God will do. But what is he talking about here? I remember attending this church, and every single service they would do an altar call. And I remember One guy I knew, every Sunday he would go up for the altar call and he would give his life to God again and again. You know, 52 times a year he was very faithful in his dedication to doing that. And I used to make me so angry, but what can you do? Like, grab him and sit down. You see, this person had an incorrect view of both Christ and salvation, right? Because when your son or your daughter messes up, do you kick them out of your family? I hope not. No. Right? They never stop being family. And they don't have to submit a request to rejoin the family either. God hates sin. We know that. He is a holy and a perfect God. But he loves you and I. And when we come before him and we repent and we ask for forgiveness, his mercy does not cease for us, church. And we can have this position because the righteousness of Christ has been imputed to us. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We will practice righteousness because we are righteous, because he is righteous, and we have righteousness, his righteousness imputed to us. Church, we know that there is not one of us here who does not sin. If there is, stand up so we can stone you. There's not one of us here who does not sin. Right? Whilst we walk on this earth, we will battle with our flesh daily, just like the Apostle Paul, just like Peter, just like the other disciples, and every other disciple of Jesus throughout history. Paul talks about his flesh in Romans 7, right? How he does the very thing that he hates. So we aren't talking when, as a disciple, you sin and grieve the heart of God, but then in humility ask for his forgiveness. This is a normal occurrence within the Christian walk. Instead, what John was talking about here was this habitual pattern of sin, living with this pattern of sin. He says, whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil. Those who make a practice of it, those who find ongoing pleasure in their sin, those who feel no remorse for their continued sin against a holy God, those who find no inner conflict in sitting in church on a Sunday anticipating the sin that they're going to commit when they leave this place. This is what he was talking about. 1 Corinthians 6, 9-10 makes it very clear regarding those who make a practice of sinning. People don't like reading this one anymore. And they like to change the words. They go, well, if you look in the Greek, it really means something completely different. 1 Corinthians 6, reading from 9. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. You see, these people show proof, according to 1 John, that they have not been born of God. They haven't been regenerated. Because if they truly were, they would not be making a practice of sin. And as disciples, church, we cannot pick and choose from that list either. So what should our lives look like? I think we all know we should be growing in holiness. The Holy Spirit's sanctifying work should be forever evident in our lives. And sanctification is a state of separation unto God. And all believers enter into this state when they are born of God. Just as we read in 1 Corinthians 6:11. Verse 11 tells us this. It's just, we've just finished reading about those who practice sin. It says, and such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of God. And this is what the believer's life looks like. A life where there is sanctification ongoing. And it is not a perfect life. It is not a sin-free life. It is not a doubt-free or a struggle-free life. It is not a life where we do not have blind spots, nor a life where there is no need for the great surgeon to come with the scalpel and cut sin and self out of our lives, right? But it is a life on an upward trajectory, a gradual sanctifying, a gradual progression to holiness, no matter how fast or how slow it may be. Right? Because when you've been regenerated, when the Spirit of God comes to dwell within you, there will be evidence of sanctification in your life, small or big. What matters more is that the work is ongoing. And we know what the Christian life is like. Oftentimes it can be, you know, two steps forward, one step back. But when the Holy Spirit is dwelling within you, when you have been born of the Spirit, when you've been transformed by the Holy Spirit to the likeness of Jesus, you know, each day is not perfect, but you are gradually becoming more and more like God's Son. And if there is zero evidence of that in our lives, then we do have reason to question and say, am I saved? If you are committed to walking right before a holy God and submitting to the Holy Spirit's perfecting work, then this is a proof that you have been saved. Church, are you who you once were? Are you who you once were? And if not, that's a proof. And the third proof is social. You should have assurance of your salvation if you love other Christians. 1 John 3:14. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Speaking of the family of God, the church. Whoever does not love abides in death. Whoever does not love abides in death. Strong words, not from me, from John. This is a proof that we are saved, church. Right? That we have love for. Not just the church as an idea, like, oh yeah, I guess the church is good. But if we love our fellow brothers and sisters. And this is why, and you can quote me on this, I do not believe that you can be a genuine disciple of Jesus, right, and say that you don't want anything to do with the church, his bride, or your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I don't believe it. And people tell me, I'm a Christian, but I don't believe in this church. No, I'm not interested in that. You can't. And it's not just one scripture. Look throughout the New Testament. You look at the pattern. Whoever does not love abides in death. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Has anyone here... I can ask this in the Philippines and I'll get a big response, but let's see. Has anyone here ever killed a chicken?
Yeah. Rooster.
Werner. Was that a hen? It was. Wicked. Nice. No, okay. Oh, it's a good amount. Have killed a chicken, killed a rooster, right? Okay. What can happen when you cut the chicken's head from its body? It can still run. If you Google this, maybe no, don't Google this. It's kind of messed up. But there was a chicken that was in like the Guinness World Book of Records because they cut its head off and it survived. And it survived for like, not just like a minute, it survived for like, it just continued on with its life, and they used to feed it through a straw. Yeah. Google that. It's an interesting story. I don't know what happened to their dinner, but anyway. But you've seen it. Yeah, it ran away. Exactly. Right? It's terrible. But when you cut a chicken's head from its body, as many of you experience, the chicken will it'll still run for a period of time. Right? But you cannot separate the head from the body, right? Because we know it's incompatible with life. And you cannot seek to separate Christ from his body because it is incompatible with life. And if you have no desire to love the brothers, love the sisters, then this is proof that you have not passed out of death and into life. Instead, it tells us we abide in death. And I spoke about this recently on our Saturday night service, but we see so much Lone Rangerism in the church in the West. Well, sorry, in the West, not in the church. You know, it's that attitude that says, I'll do it myself. I can just do church at home, myself and my wife. We don't need the body of Christ, right? And then we twist that little thing. We say, when two or three are gathered, that's church. No, it doesn't say that. It says God's there, but he's dwelling in you and I. We already know that. But God never intended for you to sit at home with your partner and say, this is church. It's close to 100 one another scriptures in the New Testament. Right? The Christian life was designed to be lived out in community. So not only are we called to be in community and in family with one another, we're told, hey, we've got to love one another. And in fact, it's not just something that you have to Grit your teeth and bear it and force yourself to love. What are the signs that you have passed from darkness into light? Is that you love the brothers. John 13:35. By this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Right? I've spoken about this before. There's that Greek word philio that we read sometimes in the New Testament, the Greek word for love. It's a friendship, it's a fondness, it's an affection, a feelings-based love, right? And this is how we can often choose to love one another as church family. It's feelings-based, it's a friendship-type love. And this seems okay in a very superficial sense, but the problem is, what happens when the friendship is tested? What happens when someone wrongs us, they disappoint us, they fail to meet our expectations? You know, the fondness, the friendship, the affection diminishes. This person is no longer a delight to us. And then the feeling of love decreases or it outright disappears. And that is why in John 13:35, when Jesus said, by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another, he doesn't use the word filio, he uses the word agape. Right? Agape love. Unconditional love. Preferential love. Love that is chosen and acted out by the will. It is not a love that is based on the goodness of the beloved or on some sort of natural affinity towards love or emotion. This love comes because you have Christ living on the inside of you. If you look at your biological family, you will know that we often love each other imperfectly, and sometimes we fail to love the way that we should. And if you look at your church family, you'll see exactly the same thing, although I think often we hold a higher standard up for church members as well. Again, I'm not talking about us living some sort of perfect loving life, because the reality is we can't do that. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to mess up. I'm talking about this. Are you and I committed to loving our brothers and our sisters in Christ? Are we committed to allowing the Holy Spirit to empower us to show that agape love more and more? When you get it wrong, instead of abandoning ship, do you pick yourself back up and keep going? Or do you just look for another church family or no church family at all? When others get it wrong, do you extend to them the same mercy that the Father had towards you when he sent his Son to die for you? If your answer to these things is yes, then you have proof of your salvation, that you have indeed passed from death into life if you have love for the brothers. Examine yourself to see that you are in the faith. I'm not responsible, neither are you, for yourself. You're not responsible for your justification, nor do you have to bring about your own regeneration. God is the only one who saves church. But next time you doubt, the next time the enemy comes to try and confuse you or to bring doubt or to make you ask the question, am I saved? How do I know that I'm saved? Go back to the Word of God and look for the proofs that exist in the life of every true believer born of God. Theological, moral, social. And when you do that, rebuke the devil and roll back in over in your bed and go back to sleep. And sleep well, knowing that not only are you saved, but that salvation was a gift that you never had to earn. Rather, it was from God, who great in mercy, and because of the great love that he had for you, sent Christ to secure your salvation and abundant life. And no one can take that away from you. Okay, why don't you stand with me this morning? Let's pray.
Great truth. Great.
Father, thank you that we don't have to wonder. We don't have to wonder if we are saved in the way that someone would wonder when there's no true answer to a question. But thank you that you have given us an answer in your word. Thank you, Lord God, that we were dead, so dead in our sins. And whilst we were still in that predicament, in that mess, that you sent your Son to die for us.
Thank
because you are rich in mercy and because of your great love for us. Lord, we're not perfect, Father, but we believe that Jesus, your Son, is God.
Yes, 100%, yes.
We've put our trust in Him this morning,
yes,
Lord God. And we have His righteousness imputed to us.
Yes.
So that when you look at us, Father God, you don't see the filthy rags. But you see white robes. We've been washed by the blood of the Lamb, the perfect Lamb.
Yes.
And so, Father God, we make mistakes and we sin, but thank you that there is forgiveness when we turn to you. Thank you, Lord, that your Holy Spirit is sanctifying us each day, making us more like your Son. Help us to love each other through your Holy Spirit's empowerment the way that we should. Let that be an example to the world. And let that be evidence to each other, to ourselves, to a lost and hurting world, that we are not only your disciples, that we have been saved. Salvation is with us and lives within us. Thank you, Lord God, for your goodness. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you, church.
Right.
Please hang around.